Welcome to our webinar, to MHP webinar, when to file a patent application and how much data is enough. Today's speaker is Dr. Torsten Exner. He is partner of our firm and he holds a degree in biochemistry and got his PhD in pharmacology. He is our expert in pharma. And before we jump into the webinar, I just want to explain that whenever you have a question, please post the question into the chat. And I will try to interrupt Torsten at a time and then ask the question. And so whenever you have a question, please post your questions into the chat whenever you it comes up. Okay, so Torsten, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I'm glad that we can focus on the slides and not on the image of the camera because I turned off the auto adjustment and it's getting brighter and brighter over here. I can see on my own picture. We are talking about today about filing data. First, this some of you may already know the slide about myself. I'm a biochemist and I have after doing my PhD in pharmacology, I've worked as a researcher. Like many other patent attorneys before I moved into the IP area. I started in Singapore as a candidate and I'm now a member. Now I'm first a German and a European patent attorney. I'm admitted before the UPC. I'm a member of the EQE committee, which means I'm a marker of the European bar exam. And I'm a member of the biotech committee of the EPI. Now, if we talk about data, let's start with the following scenario. You have received an invention disclosure and there is some time pressure. Either the researcher wants to publish a publication in a journal or the invention is going to be commercialized, but before that, IP is to be secured, typically in the form of a patent application. Or you know that your competitor has a similar project and you don't want to be second in line. And the field is in what the US calls the unpredictable arts, meaning life science or chemicals, and in chemicals, typically pharmaceuticals. Now in your invention disclosure, there are no or only limited data. And what does this mean? Can you go and file? Well, if you have no data, I would suggest you don't file because that's most likely going to give you problems. I've had one application, something like 10 years ago, where indeed no data were needed, but that was a special case because you could, in principle, rely on the common general knowledge to a large extent, which of course meant we had some problems with inventive step. But otherwise, let's say you have limited data. Now, what is limited data? And I would say, as we will see in the following slides later on, what you really need is quantity. Typically, you think about quality, but quantity in two dimensions is what we will see later on. And that is, in principle, the case worldwide. What we are not going to cover today is dosage regimens. That is what Uli had last month. And that's also a special area where the hurdle is a bit different than in other areas. So we leave that out. We have a bit more references to case law and guidelines than I initially thought we would have. But if you want to read more about case law last year after the decision by the Enlarged Board of Appeal at the EPO, G2 of 21. I can refer you to my article in the EPI information, volume one of this year. There are about 10, 12 cases last year where data played a role, and it may also be interesting to take a look at those cases because there you can see which data were present and which were not and what consequences that had. Also for post-filing data. Now, if you're filing an application, you probably won't be interested only in the EPO. So it doesn't make that much sense to have EPO case law only. It makes sense because to have some of it, because often it applies in other jurisdictions as well. What the Enlarged Board of Appeal says, But there are so many jurisdictions. I hope you can see my cursor here. You need some more generalized approach and some more generalized idea. It's a variety of countries which you can go for as options if you go for a PCT application. Plus, sometimes also, if you can see my cursor here, this island here is Taiwan, often also of interest. So, okay, this does not work. Now it does. Principally, underlying all the requirements that also apply to data, all based on this underlying idea, you often find it in EPO case law, especially it's found in case law from the UK. Here's a decision from the last decade, which is well known. They call it the patent bargain. You could also call it the quid pro quo, meaning as an inventor, you get a monopoly for maximally 20 years. And after that monopoly has ended, what you have invented goes into the public domain, which means that the public must be able to, after that year, in these 20 years, must be able to work your invention and carry it out. That's the quid pro quo. And that's also for the amount of value of data important, which you have to include into your application. Now let's take a look at relevant factors, which you should consider when it comes to data. Of course, always the most important, the circumstances of the case, but that doesn't help us much for a talk like this. Circumstances of the case are, for example, you get with your invention disclosure, you get data, and from these data, you understand what the core of the invention is. But just the control question is, I find, always helpful. Now that you understood where you think, this is how it works, do you really have data on that aspect? Very often you do, but sometimes it may be helpful to go back to the inventors and ask for that special step. For example, here, if, let's say, one of these curves would be an effect in the presence of a compound, blood pressure or binding or something like that, and the other one would be the control, then it would be what you really need for filing a patent application is one data point in the presence and one data point in the absence of this compound. So one control, something like that. A curve like this, of course, is more illustrative, but sometimes it's also additional information. Now, the other relevant factors, general factors, of course, the patentability requirements, that's sufficiency, or call it enablement. Written description requirement, which is something you find only in the US, and inventive step, which are, again, like sufficiency, find worldwide. That is the patentability requirements. Then you have, with regard to these requirements, the burden of proof. So, put it differently, how high is the hurdle? So that you can convince a judge, a court, a board, or there may be a presumption, which is this one, which would be in your favor, so that it is assumed that something works. And another aspect is genus, species, the considerations. If you think about genus, species, it may be that your first thought is we can quickly deal with this within one, two slides. I have a slide on that. But in my view, the considerations with regard to genus, species are very important and affect all the other patentability requirements. If you replace genus with, say, claimed range or the range of the claim, and species with embodiment, then you will see that this is something you very, very often find in decisions of courts and appeal boards. And consequence of that is, well, I would here like to call it diversity. When I was a candidate, the kind of rule of thumb was, if you only have one example, it's unlikely that's going to be enough. If you have three examples, it would work in many cases. But that's, again, a question of the case at hand. let's say you have an effect which occurs only in a certain pH range, let's say from not too acidic to slightly basic, say you have it, then you may want to go for a pH range from 6 to 8, and then data points like pH 6, pH 4, and maybe pH 8 or close to 8 would be good to have that. It sounds very trivial, but I've often seen that it is overlooked if you have another factor that is more or appears more important, say a certain concentration or a certain temperature is more important, and suddenly all your examples only are done at pH 6.5 or something like that. So this is something we will also take a look at later on, a kind of second dimension for your data. Yeah, we will see that under the written description requirement and the inventive step, that like in this example, you shouldn't always have pH 6.5, for example. Now, what you can very often do in almost all jurisdictions, if you don't have enough data in your application upon filing, you can later on during prosecution or afterwards before a court file additional data, or before an appeal board if you're in opposition proceedings. And from what happens with these additional data, to what extent they are considered, you can draw conclusions about what is necessary to be included in your application and what is something that you can still file later on. And these generalizations are also interesting to see worldwide. We'll take a brief look at that later. It's not the same worldwide. We will start with the first factor now, one of these patentability requirements, sufficiency. Then we will continue with written description and inventive step. Maybe just a comment, typically written description requirement is grouped together with sufficiency. I have purposely grouped it here together with inventive step, because in my view, there are also good arguments why you can group it this way. So we start with sufficiency, sufficiency of disclosure, call it enablement. This is from a trial board decision in an appeal in Korea. We'll take a look at a bit at Korea in a few of the next slides. Korea has a special high hurdle for sufficiency of disclosure. They use different wording, but in principle, they regard the area or the ranges of pharmaceuticals or life science in general as the unpredictable arts. They use different wording here, but in principle, they say we are here in the area of unpredictable arts, and there you need experimental data. If you don't have data in your application, the invention is regarded as not complete upon filing. And then the question is, how many data, what kind of data do you need there? What they then say here, especially in medical use, you need to show the pharmacological effects. There they really mean pharmacological effects. It can be anything like receptor binding, anything like an effect. In China, sometimes I have the impression if they talk about pharmacological effects, they mean something like animal studies and not in vitro studies. But otherwise, you see here, there are decisions cited from the beginning of the century. You practically always find that in Korea during the first 10 years of the century is up to some, typically up to something like 2010, they cite the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court sets a really high hurdle. And the Supreme Court, interestingly, also does not distinguish between method claims, medical use claims, and product claims. That's the difference from other countries. So if they talk about medical use invention here, they mean invention in terms of think of unity of invention, this kind of category, not the invention as defined in your claim, as you would otherwise think. So generally, what does the law in different countries say about sufficiency? It's in principle always the same. It must be possible for the skilled person to perform the inventions we have here in the UK the same in Germany must be enough to be carried out by this skilled person under the EPC. Korea, it says to ensure that a person with ordinary knowledge can easily carry out the invention. It's very much the same in all countries. To work the invention in Japan, enable the person skilled in the art in Brazil, Argentina, an average person skilled in the art to be able to carry it out. China, enable a person to carry it out, and so on. Taiwan, similar, carry out the invention by the person skilled in the art. In the US, you actually have three requirements within one section of the law. That's firstly the written description requirement, and enablement, and the best mode. And here, but it, here it also says that the specification needs to enable the person skilled in the art to carry out the invention. So it's the same requirement wherever you look at. And if you look at also the beginning, it always talks about the description or the specification. If you take a look at the different countries, the only difference is in obviously in the Korean language and in the Chinese language, description has a different scope, obviously, than in English. So otherwise, it's the specification, and description is obviously broader in Chinese and Korean. So it's also more than literally just the, say, detailed description of the invention. They also mean the disclosure, actually. Now, the court and the appeal boards fill this requirement by law with life. This is from the EPO case law book, this first part. As an opponent, I always cite this requirement. You need to show over the whole scope of the claim without undue burden against the common general knowledge that the person skilled in the art can carry out the invention. It's a very similar requirement in the US. This is a decision from a few years ago. Firstly, as in we saw in the previous regulations in the law, it's the priority date. If it's the description or the application that is referred to, of course, it must be present upon the filing date. Here they emphasize this, it's the filing, the priority date. It's the person skilled in the art who is the standard, and across the full scope, in this case, the claims related to nucleic acids. Here, the skilled person did not have enough common general knowledge. So the standard is very much the same as before the EPO. Here, the Andean guidelines say something about the consequences. If you don't fulfill this requirement, it may happen that if you don't fulfill this requirement, that you're not able to remedy it. Because if you don't have it in your application as filed, you would run into an extension of scope, which is not allowable. So you cannot proceed to grant with this a claim, at least like this you have there. Similar requirement in India. Here, the guidelines for pharmaceutical applications say that if you seek protection for something not identified in the application at the time of filing, it will not be possible to patent it. The EPO says in its recent decision, G2 of G21, the enlarged board says, firstly, it's the date of filing. That is the kind of threshold that you need to have all your data to fulfill the sufficiency requirement. And in this case, here is the effect, is a therapeutic application. And if you have an issue there, it cannot be remedied by evidence, so data that are filed after filing, so post-filing data. And also the enlarged board here says that the requirements in terms of sufficiency and inventive step are different. In terms of sufficiency, the hurdle is much higher than for inventive step, and there's much less room for you as an applicant to fulfill the sufficiency requirement or enablement requirement than under the inventive step assessment. Now, does this sound scary? It may, But if you take a closer look, we will do that in the following slides, it's not quite as bad as it sounds. Firstly, that's what we will take a look in the next slides. You should distinguish between a product and the use of it. If you have a product, it may be an idea to first go for protection of that product. And within 18 months before the publication of this application happens, go for another application with hopefully more data on the use of this product. And secondly, we are here talking about patents and patent applications, not about peer-reviewed journals. So the hurdle in terms of quality is not the same as for some journal article. Here, it's just enough to convince the board, the judge, the examiner, and it's not some group of experts who are reviewing your paper before it can be published. That's also a big difference. So if you take a look again at what I just had in decision G2 of 21, they talk about second medical use claims here, the requirement. And there they say that the hurdle is this high. Here it's the claimed therapeutic application where this high hurdle applies. It's not a product claim. And that is something which is really important, which we will also see in the next slides. You have to distinguish between a product and a use. The requirements are different. What you assess is what you have in your claim. For a use claim, you have in your claim an effect, and for a product claim, you don't. This is what the enlarged board at the EPO firstly had in its decision G1 of 03, actually a decision on disclaimers, but they also addressed the question whether the case at issue was to be assessed under sufficiency or inventive step. And there the enlarged board said, it depends what there is in the claim. If there's an effect that is expressly defined in the claim, then this effect has to be assessed in terms of sufficiency of disclosure. If the effect is not expressed in the claim, then we don't have an issue of sufficiency of disclosure. Then this effect is something that is to be assessed in terms of inventive step. So the hurdle that we had here is in fact only applies for what you really have in the claim. And if you don't have an effect in the claim, that is something for inventive step, where the enlarged board also said the hurdle is much lower than for sufficiency. This is also repeated here in the recent decision, G2 of 21, where the enlarged board said that here you have a technical effect defined in the claim. And for a second medical use claim, of course, that is something like a therapeutic effect. In this case, it was. And as it is a feature in the claim, it has to be assessed in terms of sufficiency. Not all guidelines worldwide are this clear, but if you think of invention, meaning what you have defined in your claim, in principle, it's always there, but expressly there. Here, the technical effect is, for example, here in the EPO guidelines. If you look at Brazilian guidelines, it's not really there. Here in the Andean guidelines, at least it says claimed area. Korea, as we said, it says the effect and the medical effect, but as we had, the Supreme Court didn't really make this distinction between product and use. So this doesn't really help you here. It only says that as soon as somewhere there is a medical effect, you are at this high hurdle of sufficiency. In China, it talks about the technical effect, yes, in the guidelines. In Singapore, also achieved the defined results. So what does this mean in real life? Here we have one real life example, a bit generalized because it doesn't really help to look into the details of one specific case. In this case, we had binding, for example, think in terms of a compound binding to a receptor. And we didn't have any data in the form of figures, or let's say in the form of specific values, like numeric numbers. We only had a table which in principle said yes, no. So the only information we had in the application was whether or not there is binding or not. And as you can see here, in most countries, this was sufficient. In Australia, we got a grant. In China, we got a grant without medical use. At the APO, the application is still pending. We only will have to limit the medical uses, and then it looks like we are good to go for grant. In Japan, we had to cancel the treatment. We could go to grant with diagnosis, but not with the treatment. In Taiwan, claims were granted, US also. In Colombia and in India, there are no medical uses allowed. So in principle, we had the same scope as in China, but because the law doesn't allow medical uses. And then you see here in Korea, the application was refused, and that was confirmed in appeal. So here you see again that, as I mentioned initially, in Korea, the hurdle is higher. What the board here said is, in principle, they don't expressly say it, but in principle, they said this table with this yes-no indication is not something that we regard as data. They said here then, if you don't, you have nice post-filing data in all jurisdictions. We also filed post-filing data, which had curves and specific values. What the trial board here said is you should have had that in your application as filed. If we would consider these data now, it would be giving you grant rights after you have completed the application of filing. This is something we cannot do here, and no protection in Korea here. If you want to compare the situation in world and across the world worldwide, it's almost a hopeless struggle because you cannot really, have all the grades, the different levels in each country. If you want to generalize a little bit, this is what I did try to do here. This is based mainly on the comments we got from our colleagues and also from the experience that we have at the EPO. You can in principle distinguish between countries where you normally need, at least in the pharmaceutical and chemical areas, some sort of data. That's the yellow countries. The green jurisdictions are those where something must be present in the application, not necessarily data. I can confirm that actually for Eurasia. Then there are countries where you simply are not allowed to file post-filing data. That's here South Africa and Algeria. And then you have here Colombia. You need some support in the claims, interestingly, as filed, not just the application, but otherwise it's very much similar to other countries. And then you have the US, where the real hurdle is the written description requirement. Otherwise, it's a country that is similar to the yellow countries here. Some data should normally be included. If we consider the experience that we have in China, Korea, Japan, maybe you should put it like this. Korea has a special high standard. Actually, about China, I cannot really give a complete indication on the color yet because we have quite a number of applications that are pending before the appeal board in China. They seem to have a huge backlog, and it's back until before the corona crisis occurred. Applications are still pending before the appeal board without having any assessment so far. So it could be that China turns into something more yellow or something more orange. So how come that so little data, something like a table, which just says something like yes, no, is sufficient in most countries? The first aspect is what I have copied here from the EPO's case law book. That is, under sufficiency, you have a presumption. You will know that as an opponent. If there are questions, no. As an opponent, you will know that it's really difficult to challenge a claim under sufficiency or enablement if you don't have data. And that is due to this presumption. The presumption means it is assumed that if you claim something, what you claim there works. And that presumption is even stronger after grant. So there you really need data, which means in turn for you as an applicant, there is the presumption that what you file there really works. It's my impression that this may not always be the case that is considered in China, but as I said, we don't have yet confirmation from the appeal board. Another aspect, as I mentioned initially, firstly, of course, the hurdle in terms of the presumption, and secondly, in terms of the quality that you need to show. Here, another excerpt from the case law book of the EPO. It is here, the first section here, that's the mouse here. It's only necessary to render it plausible that the effect that you claim occurs. So the evidence that you need to file is only, it's plausible. It's not sort of, you have to prove up to that it's highly unlikely. So the hurdle is only that, here they put it, the experimental tests have to concern an effect that is related with the disease, and they have to make it plausible that there is a connection with the disease. It can be any in vitro examples. And here in the, okay, there we have a question. I don't see it here.
I can read it to you. How important are reference examples or negative data in the different jurisdictions?
Negative data in the sense that what you find in the prior art doesn't work, in that case, it's so far from my experience enough to have that as post-filing data. Normally something where I wouldn't worry about that much if you file the application. Typically, that's something where an examiner finds something, you have prior art cited against you, and that's normally something that you can address after the filing in response to or attacks from an opponent or before the court, where you then can file comparative data showing that what is cited against you is in principle not working as they claim. This in almost all jurisdictions that you have the same level or the same standard in terms of sufficiency of disclosure as for your own application. So you the cited prior art against you has to meet the same standard. It's not quite the same in the US, but otherwise it's always an argument that you can bring after filing. If we come back to the slide here, the second thing is cited here, which is in terms of quantity in the case law book of the EPO. Here's a decision cited in the next chapter in the case law book, where the board says we only have two compounds here in the application of filed data on two compounds which are structurally very similar. And this is the other aspect here, the whole scope of the claim. And here the board said, we don't see that this is sufficient for the whole scope claimed. For these two compounds, yes, but for the claimed range, this is not sufficient. And we take a look at the next slide. So the first thing is, in terms of quality, it's only sufficient that it is more likely than not that there is an effect, and this effect is related to the disease. In terms of quantity, it's important that you have something spread about the scope of the claim that you're going for the range that you're going for. That, as I initially mentioned with the pH, here it's for molecules. If the molecules are too similar, It will often be difficult to go for a range of compounds which cover all sort of substituents, especially if the backbone of the compound is not the same. Then you are easily running into trouble in terms of sufficiency of disclosure for the whole scope. The written description requirement is the next requirement we are going to briefly take a look at. This is much shorter. Generally, I'm not talking about U.S. law here because I'm not an admitted U.S. agent. Also, the requirements in the U.S. are often different from the rest of the world. So I'm not talking much about the U.S., but in this case, we need to have at least an idea to everybody be on the same level what the written description requirement is about. So we've already taken a look at this section in the U.S. law. It contains three different requirements. If you take a look at the written description requirement here, it only says something about process, manner of making it and using it. And the courts have made all of this part of the section here that it means that you need to show possession of the invention of the relevant date. That's in principle what is always the underlying standard for the written description requirement. In Korea, the sufficiency requirement is clearly coined on the written description requirement, but it has a much higher standard than the US written description requirement. What you often have is these species genus generalizations, think in terms of embodiment and scope of a claim. What you often have also is result to be achieved attacks or objections, rejections, as they say in the US. So this written description requirement turns out to be something like a reservoir for all sort of objections and attacks that you in other jurisdictions find codified in different requirements in terms of patentability. It can also concern added matter, as in this case. What we are really interested for data here is the species genus issue. They have two cases here in the US. The first one is this one, a case from the last century, which kind of established the requirement for, in this case, DNA. So for everything relating to compounds, the claim here concerned DNA encoding insulin, and the claim, which was a dependent, well, it was not really a dependent claim. It's in the under the US drafting rules, you can draft it as an independent claim. It concerned human insulin encoded clearly. And what the application had, the data included, was a sequence of rat insulin. And there the court said that written description requirement requires more than just any DNA sequence. You must define what you claim here. So rat insulin was not sufficient to claim human insulin. And claim one at issue here was more general. It was vertebrate insulin, but because there was only rat insulin in the application, in principle, the same standard applied here. Rat insulin does not support vertebrate insulin. For the same reason, this claim also failed. And the court said, in this case, what you have to conclude here is the genus that the applicant or patentee here went for was not supported by this one species. If they had more, at least human insulin included as well, which they didn't, the situation under the written description requirement would have looked much different, more different from that. Another case, this is one of those unfortunate cases which undid with the call of antibody exception in the US. If you think instead of an antibody, think of a protein here, and don't think too much in terms of antibodies. The claim defined let's say protein in terms of its binding properties and in case of the cutoff rate of this binding. The court here said, firstly, binding is a functional definition. It can cover any structure. There was a large number of antibodies in the examples, but all these antibodies, they are binding to this target defined in the claim. All these antibodies are derived from one lead antibody. And all these antibodies therefore had very similar structure, same heavy chains and light chain types. I mean, as I said, this is a bit strange for an antibody claim, but this is the standard that the court here established. And they said the K-off rate is also allowed to be achieved for a protein. This is not enough. And in this case, the genus was not even supported by these 300 species. More different species in terms of structure would have led to a different result, but here the case also failed. So this tells us something about the written description requirement. What does this mean? Is there anything special for the written requirement? I would say not really. This is about the scope, the range of the claim, and the examples that you need to cover. You really need, in terms of quantity, it's similar to what the EPO said in the case law book cited in the decision. You need really different embodiments, not some variations of the same embodiment, and then you're fine. So again, in terms of quantity, you need to have a bit of variance, as I had initially. Okay, there's a question, but I only see the beginning.
Maybe before we continue. If you file a first priority without data due to conference presentation, quick and dirty, then some weeks later you file a second priority, including extensive data set, does this first priority date hold?
Again, you have to distinguish here between do you have a product and do you have effect in terms of medical use or some method claiming an effect to be achieved with what you have here. If it's just the requirement in terms of you have to, okay, there was just an issue here. You may have to, you will have to rely in terms of sufficiency most likely on the second application as filed. In terms of inventive step, no data, as I said, no data is critical. I've had a case where no data was sufficient because you could rely on the skilled person's common general knowledge. The only difference was the use. So for, and we also could go for the use in that case, the use was related, but different from what was known so far. And there we had to had to convince examiners in terms of inventive step, and that was enough. But here I would say the quick and dirty filing without any data is highly risky, that you lose the first date, and that is, it's likely you have to rely on the second date. But yeah, it depends on the case, but there I would see a high risk without any data. And so then here we can continue. If you have only one, we just had the variety of in terms of quantity and the low level in terms of quality, also for the written description requirement. So it's not really much more in the US with the written description requirement that you have to fulfill if you compare it to sufficiency at the EPO. So the difference between written description requirement and enablement seems to be more a US difference. And the last aspect in terms of patentability is inventive step here. This is also relatively short. Inventive step is in most countries assessed under the problem solution approach, where you have first to identify the closest prior art, have to identify the difference of the claim, the claim subject matter, let's put it, to the closest prior art, take a look what the technical effect of this difference is, and on that basis identify the problem to be solved And in all these cases, again, it's the entire scope of a claim or the technical effect and the problem to be solved have to be fulfilled or assessed. What you, in terms of data to be filed in your application, have to take a look again here. Mostly is the technical effect that is being assessed, the entire scope of the claim that is being assessed, which then also affects the problem to be solved. The aspect of the problem to be solved has been entirely circumvented by the enlarged of appeal in its last decision, G2 of 21. So it's actually the effect. There are some countries that don't apply the problem solution approach. That's the US, Japan, and South Korea. And the US, you have the written description requirement instead. And in Japan and South Korea, you still have something which resembles the problem solution approach. Firstly, you have a higher hurdle in terms of sufficiency. And then if you have a technical effect, it's always convincing if you can argue along the lines, and you can even argue along similar lines as along the problem solution approach. So in principle, even though they don't have the last step of the technical effect, if you argue along this line, you are very often successful as in other jurisdictions. We had for sufficiency the different grades, the higher hurdle in Korea. If you look at inventive step, it looks a bit more harmonized. Korea, China, Japan, they have in principle the same standard, as I just mentioned, as other countries. Here, I also still see a little bit of a difference that in some countries you don't really need data in your applications at these green countries. It's enough to have something because, of course, in terms of inventive step, you cannot predict what the closest prior art will be, but still some sort of data that you can rely on are always helpful in all these countries that are yellow labeled here on the map. If we take a look at what some colleagues told us, this is here the EPO first. This is what the Enlarged Board of Appeal told us. They said in decision G2 of 21, what you need is enough disclosure in your application, not necessarily data, so that anything you file in response to an assessment in terms of inventive step is that the effect that you rely on must be encompassed by the technical teaching. The second requirement, which is still not really that harmonized, if you take a look at the appeal board decisions, is that it must also be embodied by the original disclosed invention. So sounds a bit like unity of invention, but as far as I've seen so far, if it's encompassed by the technical teaching, then obviously it's also embodied by the originally disclosed invention. In the UK, you cannot file something, some data relying on an effect that is not in your application as filed, so very similar to the EPO. In China, what our colleagues tell us is also that the technical effect must be somehow be found or derivable from the specification. So sounds a bit similar to the EPO. In Japan, it's also that the effect must already be found in the specification as filed. In South Korea, where the hurdle in terms of sufficiency is really high, they tell us, similar to the EPO, that the effect must be described in the specification. It's also possible that you can infer the effect from the specification. In Australia, again, it must be present somehow in the specification. If you take a look at Korea here, what they tell us, it's similar to what we had at the EPO here. It's not even necessary to expressly have the effect named in the application. It's enough to infer it. The APO case law book also has decisions which in principle say the same here. This is from the case law book, a decision here, which was issued after decision G2 of 21. They refer to this decision and they say that the technical effect does not really expressly need to be named. It's enough to be derivable from the application. So here, obviously, there was no mention of the technical effect, but the technical effect could be derived from what the application disclosed, and that was already enough. And of course, it's since the beginning of the EPO assessments that it is or has always been possible to file post-filing data. In Taiwan, in principle, the same. Either the effect is explicitly disclosed or it's easily deduced from the application as filed. So what does this tell us about an inventive step and data included in your application as filed? All this sounds, again, similar to the written description requirement that you need to show possession of the invention at the relevant date, so the filing date. There must be some mention in the application. So that means something must be in the teaching, which as an applicant means you need to tell the drafter what all could be possible, what effects might occur. And that, of course, is always helpful if there are some sort of data. Only telling may bear the risk that something is missed out. So if some data, meaning you don't know yet the closest prior art. Your invention is based on an effect, but the technical effect may be very, very similar to what is already in the closest prior art. You don't know it yet. So the technical effect that you have to rely on later on as well, maybe something else. It must be found or be derivable from the application as filed. It can be supported with data later on, but there must be something in the application. So that means there should be maybe another effect, maybe related, in addition to, let's say, you have found a certain technical effect in terms which you show in terms of binding, in terms of whatever, labeling with an antibody which gives you some signals, maybe something else like the time required or the intensity, something else that is associated with a technical effect, but it may be helpful to include it in the application as well, because that may be an additional advantage against prior art cited against you, which you don't know yet, but which you later on may have to rely on. So this is what I would call an additional dimension in terms of quantity. So not just a quantity in terms of, say, different embodiments across the range that you are going for example, different compounds, but also different dimensions in terms of effect. There may be some other aspects or other effects that you could include. And if there is anything of that sort, it may be very helpful to include that in the application as well. I've also had some applications where you later on, once you see the closest prior art, think, okay, we could have had something in the application. We didn't know that, but if we had included some more aspects, well, it would have been much easier for that. So in principle, it's not really quality that you have to worry about. It's more quantity that you have to worry about, and quantity not only in that one dimension of, say, compounds, or having different embodiments, but also maybe different effects, related effects to the data that you have in your, let's say, invention disclosure. Yeah, I'm through. I've seen there was something else.
There is another question. Mm-hmm. One question is, does it really make sense to speculate on several additional effects when you can later on prove only one or two of these?
Yeah, of course, it shouldn't be too much speculation. That's something that you can still do later on. I mean, if you don't really know, Maybe it's helpful to have at least some idea in the application. The problem that you can run into if you really don't know, you just speculate what can happen if that you put the opposite of what you later on need. If you put there something like, well, we found that it is helpful to work in this and this temperature range. And maybe even the statement that other temperatures are not that helpful. And then later on you find, okay, we could also have worked at another temperature, which is something we didn't know at that time. And now this, to distinguish your invention from prior art, it may be too late. Because if you have something in your application that's also established case law at the EPO, you cannot later on rely on something which is more or less the opposite of what you state in your application. So if it's getting too vague and you don't really know, then it's maybe better not to include it in the application, or to include it so vaguely that it is not something where you shoot yourself into the knee for subsequent effects.
Are there any other questions from the audience? In the meantime, while you are thinking about your questions, I can tell you that we will post this recording onto our website. So in the next couple of days, you will see an article where you can see a recording of this of the webinar, and you can revise the slide. You can see the slides and everything. So feel free to visit our website in a couple of days to see the full recording. Yeah, there are no more questions at the moment. So last chance, but of course,
have a few minutes.
Contact Torsten Exner with email. And he delivered a tremendous amount of value here for our listeners and for me as well. I learned a lot. Thank you very much, Torsten.
Okay.
There was a lot of clapping hands and thank you, and everyone was happy.
Good. Thank you.
I like very it. Comprehensive.
Thank you for listening and for those who gave some input during the talk.
Yeah, thank you, Torsten. And as I said, the recording will be on our website in a couple of days.